Thank you. How many people in this room have been involved with Crossref for a really, really long time? Okay, some staff people. Okay. How many people in this room are new members to Crossref? Wonderful. And how many people are, their organizations have been members for a really, really long time, but they themselves are new to Crossref? Okay, a couple people. Good. It's still very dark, isn't it? We'll see. Well, it looks like it's a little out of focus. So this morning's session is going to be our boot camp session. And so for those of you who've been around for a really, really long time, you may be bored. You may want to get a cup of coffee, because this is our introduction to Crossref, and it's important that everybody has this, and we do it as, you know, everybody comes to Crossref from the same place. But if you already know all this, then it will be difficult for you. If you're new, then this is really, really important. I understand that there is coffee and snacks out there, so I'm not going to take offense if you need to leave the room and fortify yourself. So we'll do the boot camp. I have the times wrong here, but for the first hour or so. And then Chuck Kosher is going to talk about Cited by Linking, and Susan Collins is going to talk about cross-check. So let's get started with the boot camp. I'm going to give you a quick business overview, and then Patricia Feeney will talk about the technical stuff, how it all works. And then Lisa Hart is going to chime in on the finance and operations side. So without further ado, this is the business overview. If you can't tell because it's a little dark, this is the view of London from the eye, which is very near our hotel where we're staying. So this is the 30,000 foot view. I was telling my colleagues last night at dinner that I'm trying to lose half a pound this week. Now, you could look at me, I have a lot more than that to lose, but I want to lose a half a pound this week. That's my very modest goal. And my children came across this book called Eat This, Not That. Has anybody seen that? Might be a US thing. And it's like this very simple graphic book that shows you if you're going to go out to a fast food restaurant, here are the choices you can make. So I thought that might be relevant for us today. The first reason that publishers join Crossref is to get persistent, actionable IDs for their content. They also do it to drive traffic and to make their content discoverable and to enhance their readers' experience. And then finally, they do it so that they can participate in collaborative services that publishers can do only when they work together, but not on their own. So for example, we'd like to use a GPS navigation rather than having the 404 broken link problem. Okay? We want stable, persistent, reliable links and not broken links. And there's a fair amount of research that shows that the half-life of a regular URL, even in scientific publishing and in scholarly publishing, is shorter than you might want. So that's the reason that people assign DOIs. Now, notice that I did not say the reason people join Crossref is because a DOI gives you the stamp of official publishingness, right? I think we have a lot of members that join Crossref because they think they have to have a DOI to be a real publisher. Well, Crossref is not, we're not Web of Science, we're not PubMed. We don't actually require the level of publication and rigor and peer review and quality to join Crossref. Basically, to join Crossref, you have to agree to the rules. But we don't say anything about the science that you publish. And sometimes people have a misconception about that. So just to keep that in mind. Of course, we don't want a 401 or a 404 error in our books either. So what's a DOI? Well, it's a digital object identifier. Okay, and it's kind of like a barcode for scholarly literature. It's alphanumeric. It has to be unique. And it works, again, this is very, very dark, but the user basically clicks on the DOI. The DOI directory looks up to see where the URL is. That URL is given to the user in their browser, and then the user can access the content. They look like this. So DOIs in online environments should be displayed using the full URL format, which means you take a DOI and you put the HTTP dx.doi.org in front of it to make it into an actionable identifier. That first one was from Wiley. The second one, I mean, it's from DLib, sorry. The second one is from Wiley. This third one is from JST. And this fourth DOI is from a company called RedFrame, which is one of our brand new publishers. They're based in Canada. Does anybody notice anything weird about that DOI? Those of you who've been around for a long time, what's weird about that last DOI? What? It has a 5-digit handle. Okay? So we used to say a DOI prefix was 10 dot and 4 digits. We ran out of digits, so we've gone to the next 5 digits. This is really important. If you have systems that are expecting to get a 4-digit DOI prefix, you got to fix them. Okay? So we are now in the 5 digits, and presumably you could add digits forever. So this is kind of big news. And in the old days, it was all just 4 digits. Okay. So I alluded to this. The DOI syntax is you have a prefix and a suffix. The prefix represents the publisher that registered this content item as a DOI. It doesn't represent the current publisher. If you think about that, it makes perfect sense because DOIs never change, but we all know that publications do. People buy and sell titles. Okay, so the DOI stays the same. So you cannot tell from looking at a DOI who the current publisher is. You can only tell who the publisher that assigned this DOI was. Is that clear? It's subtle but important. Okay, so the prefix is assigned to the member, and the suffix is assigned by the member. So we give you, Crossref gives you our prefix, Susan Collins, who, wave Susan, arranges to assign you your prefix. She sends you an email, you get the prefix, and then you decide what scheme you want to use for the suffix. And Patricia can tell you the technical details about what can go into your suffix. So again, if you pre-pin your DOIs with the HTTP dx.doi.org, then you have the prefix, then you have your suffix, and that'll make an actionable URL that'll work in a browser and in any kind of web-aware systems. The DOI is actually a standard. It was published by ISO just this year in May. It actually was accepted as a standard in 2010, but for various technical reasons, it wasn't published as a standard until this year. It has been, for quite some time, a NISO standard. So now DOIs are both ISO and NISO standards. Okay. So how does that work in a browser? Well, you put the DOI in your address bar, and then it actually takes you to the page because it looks up the URL. And if you look at this, which you can't see at all, take my word for it, that's not a DOI. So when you resolve a DOI in your browser, you're going to see the actual URL that came from the handle system. DOIs are displayed on the response pages. Sometimes we call them landing pages. And I would just notice this is an older example, but the DOI format should be in that URL format as well. Okay. So the suffix that you assign to your DOI has to be unique within the prefix. I mentioned that the reason people join Crossref is to help with discoverability. And so how do we do that? Well, the first and most logical thing, when really what Crossref was founded for, was to increase traffic through reference linking. So I'm a user, I'm reading a journal article, I get to the references, I want to go to the things that are referenced in the citations. I click on it, the DOI takes me to the publisher that has that material and that specific article. So that's going to be inbound traffic for me. We also drive traffic through cited by linking. So here, you're looking at an article and you want to say, okay, well, what cited this article after it was published? And Crossref allows you to do cited by linking, And that's not only good for your readers because it's helpful, but it's also good because it brings traffic to you from other folks that are participating in the Cited by Linking service. I always get a little bit tripped up when I try to explain Cited by Linking, but it makes sense, right? So you want to know, we used to call it forward linking because we were thinking about all of the links that come into this thing after it was published. So we're trying to, you know, it's a time travel thing. But we changed it to Cited by Linking because it makes more sense. The other thing that CrossRef does is we distribute bibliographic metadata to our affiliates. And so we have a number of organizations. They include search engines. They include people who have end user tools, for example, paper management tools like Mendeley and Zotero and Papers and so forth. And those folks actually will take bibliographic metadata and look up the DOIs at CrossRef, and they'll make the bibliographic metadata that they have in their systems more robust from the bibliographic metadata that we have. If you think about it, the bibliographic metadata that's deposited at CrossRef should be pretty good because it came from the publishers, right? So the metadata that came from other users may not be sufficient, it may not be accurate. So they can take that data and they can munge it up or mash it up with the data that we have. And so the users get a better experience and the links are better, so that means more traffic again to your sites. So I like to I was trying to think of a good example for this discoverability bit, because you know, all of my publishing and library examples are paper-based. This is, everybody remembers, right? There's not too many young people here. This is a old-fashioned card catalog, right? This is where we used to keep all the metadata. But now just imagine all that metadata is electronic, it's at CrossRef, and so we can make that information available to these third parties, including search engines and so forth, so that it's much more easy to find what people are looking for, which means that they're actually going to end up on your site if that's what you have. Okay. So just back to suffixes for a minute. They should be consistent, logical, easily documented, and readily implemented. They should also be short. I didn't put that on the slide. That's probably the most important thing. They should be short. There's actually a DOI shortening service that CNRI has put together. It's called Short DOI. If you go to shortdoi.org, you can make a short DOI. For those people who have publicity programs where they actually tweet their latest findings and the most sort of hottest paper from their most recent issue, you can use a DOI in your tweets without using up all those valuable 140 characters. Okay, so something to keep in mind. They can be opaque. The suffixes don't have to mean anything, or they can have meaning. So that's really up to you, but they should be short. Last year we revised our display guidelines. I've said this 15 times. I'm getting the impression that I think it's important that you display DOIs as URLs. In the old days, people put DOI colon and then they put the DOI, but even that wasn't really consistent. Some people would have a space after the colon, some people would capitalize it, some people would do it upper and lowercase and so forth. Just use the URL. Okay. And these slides will be available on SlideShare, and so all the links will work here, but there is more information about the DOI guidelines at that link. A lot of times people have questions about what the difference is between CrossRef and the International DOI Foundation. And it's even more important now because we're seeing a lot of DOIs that are not CrossRef DOIs. Now, I would ask you, although I think it probably won't happen, whenever you refer to DOIs that you're depositing at CrossRef, we'd like you to say these are CrossRef DOIs. If you look in all of our marketing material, we always say CrossRef DOIs, CrossRef DOIs, CrossRef DOIs. So now there are lots of other kinds of DOIs. There are DOIs from DataCite. And the difference in DOIs isn't really the content, and I'll get to this in just a few minutes. It's the services that the registration agency provides. So the International DOI Foundation oversees the central DOI system, and it promotes the DOI as a standard. And it also allows registration agents that assign DOIs to work with each other. CrossRef is not the only registration agency. It turns out that we have deposited more DOIs than any other registration agency, but that may change. There are actually folks in the entertainment industry that are assigning DOIs to films and music. DataCite is assigning DOIs, that's closer to our space because they're assigning DOIs to scholarly data sets. Bowker hasn't been actively assigning DOIs, but they may assign DOIs to books in the supply chain to help people figure out which version of something they want to buy. So it does become a little bit complicated for the end user to figure out what all this means. A DOI is a DOI is a DOI, except when it's not a DOI. So that's why we encourage people to talk about Crossref DOIs, because if we don't have the metadata for the entertainment industry DOI, then if you came to Crossref and tried to do a search for it, we probably wouldn't be able to return a result. And that can get better as we work on interoperability among all the different registration agencies, but at this point, that's kind of the holy grail, and it's not completely in place yet. So Crossref provides this technology and the infrastructure for linking, and it also provides the business infrastructure, which means that all of you don't have to have an agreement with all of the rest of you. You just have one agreement with us. We all agree to play by the same rules, and so it's a fairly level playing field. This is a little bit dated. My guess is this says that Crossref has about 9% of the DOIs that are registered. My guess is that number is much smaller now with DataCite actively assigning DOIs to data sets. So for those of you who are interested in sort of the under the hood bit, the Corporation for National Research Initiatives runs what we call the handle system. That's actually the resolver that will take the DOI and turn it into a URL. That supports the whole DOI system. And then Crossref has services on top of the resolution for discovery. And this is just another way of looking at that. There are at least three organizations involved. Okay, so I mentioned a couple of these things. Reference linking is the most important and sort of core service. Cited by linking is also very important. Crossref metadata services allows for that discoverability. And we also have cross-check plagiarism. There are some other services. Crossmark was launched this year, and that allows researchers to identify the instances of scholarly documents that are being actively maintained by their publishers, and it also gives them some information on where you can find the most recent update or change or correction. And we'll have some more discussion about that later in the day. Crossref has been very involved with the launching of ORCID, which is the Open Researcher and Contributor ID. I think that's right. So it's kind of like identifiers for people instead of for documents. There was a very funny a headline, I think it was in Science, that said, you know, are you a number? You know, researchers turning into numbers. So the idea, and again, I think Chuck can talk about this a little bit later after we do the boot camp bit, but the idea is that Crossref schema supports ORCIDs. So if you have a researcher ID, you can, at the beginning of the year, you'll be able to deposit those ORCIDs into your Crossref metadata deposits. So what do we mean by cross-publisher? Well, you know, again, we don't have those bilateral negotiations that used to have to happen. And these numbers are completely illegible to you, but we have about 4,000 publishers. We now have more than 300,000 book titles. So a lot of my examples are journal articles, but books are the fastest growing content type. People are assigning DOIs to books, and they are assigning DOIs to book chapters, and they are assigning DOIs to reference entities from books. We have about 27,000 journal titles and 23,000 conference proceedings. And we have now reached more than 56 million Crossref DOIs. Somebody asked me about this chart. So this is actually cumulative. This is the total number of DOIs in the system since the very beginning. And so I just looked at it this morning. The number is 56.8 million, so almost 57 million. And Books are about 9% of that now. And 4 years ago, they were about 5% of that. So again, growing very quickly. This is important to think about. Remember I said the registration agency, the difference was the services. The difference isn't the content types. So sometimes I hear people say, well, if you have data, then you assign your DOIs to DataCite. And if you have journal articles, then you assign your DOIs through Crossref. It's not entirely the case. It really depends on what services you want. If you want the Crossref discoverability services, then deposit the stuff at Crossref. If you want the DataCite services, then deposit them at DataCite. They will resolve regardless. There are lots and lots of Crossref publishers that are depositing data sets with Crossref that are associated with journal articles or other scholarly documents. And that's the thing that we recommend is if this is supplementary data for a journal article or for a book chapter, then go ahead and assign it at Crossref. Just because it's a DataCite DOI doesn't mean just because it's a data DOI doesn't mean that DataCite would be the better place. If you have these huge research sets and they may have lots and lots of different articles that refer to them, then maybe DataCite might be a better place to do that. But just because they're data doesn't necessarily tell you what the better place is. Okay. We now have over 70 countries represented by our publishers, and this slide never changes. Nobody has deposited yet anything older than 1665. But we're welcome to, you know, have it. If you have something older, we'd be happy to change it. But it's from the philosophical transactions. We're not just scientific, technical, medical. We also do humanities, social science, and professional. We're seeing a lot more in the social sciences. And I think that stems from the fact that the American Psychological Association style manual now recommends DOIs in their citations. Okay. Many, many of our new publishers are open access. Crossref is completely neutral about whether they're open access or whether they're a subscription model. If you want to charge $15 million an article or if you want to make them free, Crossref doesn't care. And again, we're a not-for-profit association of publishers, and that includes publishers from all walks of life, commercial publishers, academic publishers, nonprofits, university presses, open access publishers, even institutional repositories, not for preprints, but for unique published content. We are very glad to see all of you here. We really encourage your participation, and we have a number of ways for you to do that. You're here at the annual meeting. We have a board and committees. There's a support forum, which I think Patricia will talk about a little bit later. We have two blogs. One is, they're both linked from the Crossref homepage you can take a look at. We have a quarterly newsletter, which you should all be getting. If you're not, come see us and we'll figure out why not. We have a Facebook page, a Twitter page. We're working on doing something more interesting on LinkedIn. So there are lots of different ways to figure out what's going on at Crossref. I'll finish up, but I just wanted to go over a little bit of the numbers. The fees at Crossref have not changed and are not going to change for 2013. They haven't changed for, what, 5 years, I think? So the annual membership fee is based on your revenue or turnover. One thing to keep in mind, though, here, it's really the publisher's responsibility to report changes in your revenue. Okay, so if you started out as a tiny little publisher with revenues of under $1 million a year, and now you're making $500 million a year, congratulations, and let us know so we can charge you more. The deposit fees, again, have not changed. We did do an adjustment to the book deposit fees a year or two ago. Current records are still $1. Book chapters are now 25 cents. If you have really big reference works, book chapters are a little cheaper. Back files, which we define as being 2 years old or older, are cheaper. And components and data records are much cheaper. Journal titles, I don't know how many people here are assigning DOIs to journal titles at the title level. That's free. There's no reason not to do that. Okay. So This is what you sign up for when you join Crossref. You agree to display the DOI on your response page. You agree to deposit metadata and assign DOIs to all of your current journal articles. We accept all kinds of other stuff, but you must assign DOIs to all of your current journal articles. You must, did I say must? You must link out from the references of your journals to other folks using Crossref DOIs. This is a basic requirement of membership. You can't just assign DOIs to stuff and sit back and get all that traffic from other people. You have to link out and give traffic back, okay? That's the basic tenet of Crossref. You can't have conflicts, which means that there cannot be two different articles that have the same metadata. Because if that happens, somebody comes to Crossref and says, what's the DOI? And we say, we don't know. Okay. So if you have conflicts, if you have two DOIs to the same content, then you have to fix them. And Patricia can tell you more about how you get that information, but we have reports that you're getting that identify places where you have conflicts. You promise you have to update the metadata and your URLs. If you don't update your URLs, all the DOIs will break, and people will say, DOIs, yeah, they're always broken. Let's not use them. And of course, that doesn't work for any of us because we've all invested a lot in the system. So you have to update your URLs. Some folks have embargoes, and this can be a little tricky with timing. If you put DOIs out there before they're actually deposited and live and resolving, the user doesn't know why the DOI doesn't work. All they know is the DOI doesn't work, and we get the same problem that we had before. You know, there's no point in having a DOI that doesn't actually resolve. So don't publicize them until they're actually working. One of the newer requirements that we put in the agreement is that we ask all of our members to make plans for long-term archiving. And that may mean working with another organization like Clocks, or the Dutch Library eDepot, or the British Library, or I'm blanking, JSTOR, what?
Portico.
Yes, Portico, sorry. I don't know where that went. The agreement now requires that Crossref members make their best reasonable business efforts to try to put archiving agreements in place. Again, the DOI shouldn't break just because you stop publishing a journal. You know, that goes into a dark archive, and Portico or Clocks or one of the other organizations can still make that link work. Lisa will talk a little bit more about this, but you also agree to pay your bills on time. So you join Crossref, you get an annual bill, you got to pay it annually. You deposit stuff, you get deposit fees. I'm getting so excited I like whacked the microphone. You got to pay for them. Okay. If you don't pay for them, we turn off your access. That's not good. And then the other thing that's really important is for you to update your contact information. There's a lot of transfer. People leave jobs, they come to jobs. All we really have is your email addresses. We don't do a lot of phone calls. We don't do a lot of physical letters. So if you're taking over for somebody else, we need to know about it. We need a current technical contact, business contact, billing contact, voting contact. So that's just kind of the short version of our how many page contract? 10-page contract. These are really important obligations. So with that, I will turn it over to people who know more than I do. Thank you very much. And Patricia is going to go into a little bit more detail about how the whole thing works.